Thank you for the kind words. And at the outset, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me an opportunity to present in this wonderful event. And these are my two institutes to which I was attached. I learned my nephrology at All India Institute of Medical Sciences, and I'm working as assistant professor at Institute of Liver and Biliary Sciences, and I'm very grateful.
Transplant renal artery stenosis, often called as TRAS, is the most common vascular complication following renal transplant. The incidence varies from 1 to 23%, and this variation in incidence is because of the fact that different methods have been used to diagnose transplant renal artery stenosis, and different criteria has been used to diagnose transplant renal artery stenosis. If you do monthly doctor in a post-renal transplant patient for a period of 1 year, then the incidence is around 12.4%. Whereas if you do Doppler only in symptomatic patients who present with either refractory hypertension or unexplained deterioration of renal function or flash pulmonary edema, then the incidence is around 5%. The why it is important to identify TRAS is because of the fact that it is a potentially curable cause of treatment refractory hypertension and progressive graft dysfunction. So before we go into the details, we should first understand the basic vascular anatomy of a renal transplant. So when a donor renal artery is anastomosed to a recipient's artery, it is done in two ways. One is called as the end-to-end anastomosis, in which the donor renal artery is anastomosed end-to-end to a recipient's internal iliac artery. And then this results in a graft renal artery which has three segments, a pre-anastomotic segment which is basically the recipient's internal iliac artery, and a post-anastomotic segment which is the donor artery, and an anastomotic segment. Whereas the other type of anastomosis is the end-to-side anastomosis, and this end-to-side anastomosis is done when the internal iliac is affected by severe atherosclerosis, or in case of cadaveric renal transplant where the donor renal artery is harvested along with a patch of aorta called as the Carrel's patch. So in these two situations we do an end-to-side anastomosis with an external iliac artery. Obviously we can't do an end-to-end with external iliac because it supplies the lower limb. So how does it matter whether you make an end-to-side or end-to-end anastomosis? This matters when you treat transplant renal artery stenosis. Suppose that end-to-end anastomosis has been created and this renal artery has become stenosed. You have to approach this artery through percutaneous methods by puncturing the contralateral femoral artery. Whereas if it is an end-to-side anastomosis, you can approach this transplant renal artery by puncturing the ipsilateral femoral artery. So depending on the location of the stenosis, this TRAS has been classified as anastomotic, localized or diffuse. The most common type of TRAS is the anastomotic TRAS, and this is almost always because of faulty surgical techniques, either because of deep suturing or faulty surgical techniques or improper suture material. Whereas the localized TRAS, which can be either proximal or distal, or due to a variety of reasons. The pre-anastomotic TRAS is usually because of atherosclerotic disease extending from the iliac artery into the transplant renal artery, or it can be because of the injury caused by the clamps during surgery. And post-anastomotic TRAS is usually because of, which occurs in the donor renal artery, it is usually because of again clamp injuries, or it can be because of cannulation injuries during the perfusion of the kidneys, or it can be because of improper preservation of kidney, and that is why post-anastomotic TRAS is more common in cadaveric transplants. Besides, two important etiologies that can cause post-anastomotic TRAS are chronic rejection and cytomegalovirus virus infection. And even though definitive causation have not been proved, but there is a definite strong association between chronic rejection and cytomegalovirus virus infection with post-anastomotic stenosis. Coming to the pathophysiology of TRAS, the TRAS kidney behave like a one kidney, one plate model. That means the stenosis causes ischemia to the entire renal mass, and this results in activation of the renin and angiotensin system, leading to sodium and volume retention, and it is a retained volume that maintains the perfusion to the stenotic kidney, and therefore we should not attempt to aggressively lower the blood pressure by giving diuretics or ACE inhibitors in these patients, and we have to carefully control the hypertension, and then so eventually we have to revascularize if the stenosis is hemodynamically significant. And therefore, this TRAS is a type of volume dependent hypertension with low levels of renin, unlike the two kidney one clip model where the hypertension is predominantly renin dependent. So when you say a TRAS is significant, not all TRAS need to be treated. The latex cast experiments have shown only when you occlude that graft renal artery by more than 70 to 80%, there are measurable changes in the blood flow or blood pressure. So the perfusion is affected only when the stenosis is beyond 70 to 80%. Between 50 to 70%, only when the clinical features are present, you will intervene the TRAS. Besides, catheterization studies have shown only when the pressure gradient across the stenosis is more than 15 millimeters of mercury, you need to intervene the stenosis. Otherwise, you need not intervene. As shown in this diagram, with the latex cast experiments, you can see that only when the stenosis is beyond 70%, there is a rapid drop in the perfusion pressure to the kidneys, and this results in activation of the renin-angiotensin system. So what are the manifestations of TRAS? They are almost similar to the manifestations that occur in the native renal artery stenosis. They can be asymptomatic and can be detected on routine Doppler or MR screening. They can present as renovascular hypertension, which is typically a form of accelerated or paroxysmal hypertension refractory to medications. They can present as accelerated cardiovascular disease in the form of recurrent episodes of congestive cardiac failure, stroke, or secondary aldosteronism presenting with refractory hypertension, hypokalemia, and metabolic alkalosis. They can also present with ischemic nephropathy, progressive deterioration of graft function. So these presentations are also seen in native renal artery stenosis. But one more manifestation, namely post-transplant erythrocytosis, is a manifestation that is specific to transplant renal artery stenosis. And any patient who presents with this manifestation, you have to suspect and do a Doppler before starting them on ACE inhibitors. So the main indicators of transplant renal artery stenosis are worsening or refractory hypertension, especially starting 3 months after transplant. The most common period is 3 to 24 months post-transplant. A creeping rise in serum creatinine, which is not explained by any other factor. Acute graft dysfunction, especially after you introduce an ACE inhibitor, ARB, or after aggressive lowering of blood pressure. Recurrent episodes of congestive cardiac failure or flash pulmonary edema. Post-transplant erythrocytosis. And graft bruit only if it is of recent onset, because the graft bruit in a transplant kidney is not always specific. So some points on graft bruit. The bruit over a graft kidney can be because of just physiological turbulence or post biopsy AV fistula, or it can be because of a proximal iliac vessel stenosis, often called as pseudo TRAS, and lastly it can be because of TRAS also. And that is why during every patient visit you should document the presence or absence of bruit over a graft kidney, and only a new onset bruit is of clinical significance. So what are the differential diagnoses of TRAS? The most important differential diagnosis is CNI toxicity, which presents as similar to TRAS because it is again volume dependent, and it can also present as refractory hypertension. Only difference being it is associated more commonly with hyperkalemia rather than hypokalemia. Steroid induced hypertension, pseudo TRAS, chronic rejection, hypertension due to renin from the native kidneys, recurrence of basic disease and segmental infarcts are other differential diagnoses for TRAS. So what is pseudo TRAS? When the graft blood flow is limited because of an iliac vessel disease, and this is usually seen in elderly and diabetic individuals. So apart from clinical features of TRAS that I have described, these patients also have claudication symptoms, and besides they have on examination weak femoral and distal pulses on the affected limb, and it is managed by angioplasty or surgery like TRAS. So there are two entities, namely early TRAS and late TRAS. Early TRAS is one that is present between 3 to 24 months post transplant. It is usually secondary to a surgical etiology, and it presents with acute renal dysfunction secondary to global renal ischemia. So there are no other factors causing the renal dysfunction, and therefore the response to revascularization is quite prompt and rapid. Whereas the late TRAS, which occurs after 24 months of transplant, is predominantly atherosclerotic, and there are multifactorial etiology and commonly associated parenchymal pathologies cause renal dysfunction in this case, and therefore we have to be very careful before revascularizing these patients. Because similar to the atherosclerotic renal artery stenosis that have been described, the response to revascularization is not very profound in late TRAS. So how will you diagnose? The main role of nephrologist in TRAS is diagnosis of this condition, because it is created by surgeons, treated by interventional nephrologists. So the main role of nephrologist is to suspect this condition and diagnose it. So the most important diagnostic modality is imaging. The role of renal scintigraphy and plasma renin measurements are less in transplant renal artery stenosis. The first and foremost investigation is duplex ultrasound, and followed by CT angio and MR angio. If duplex does not provide adequate information, but all these three investigations are screening tests, the confirmatory test is the digital subtraction angiography, which is both the diagnostic and therapeutic modality. But remember, not all stenosis are of clinical significance. Once you diagnose renal artery stenosis by any of these methods, you have to ensure that it is hemodynamically significant and the kidney is also salvageable before doing any intervention. So this meta-analysis, which have been done in native renal artery stenosis, have clearly shown that CT and MR angiography are definitely superior to duplex in terms of diagnosing renal artery stenosis. Then why are we performing this duplex? Duplex of graft renal artery is a combination of Doppler and color Doppler imaging, and this is always the initial investigation of choice because it is non-invasive, easily available and cost effective. And to diagnose TRAS in a renal transplant kidney, you have two approaches. First, you do an extra renal Doppler where you trace the entire renal artery, graft renal artery from the origin, from the iliac artery to the hilum. And here you measure the peak systolic velocity. The advantage of doing an extra renal Doppler is that you can localize exactly where the stenosis is. But the disadvantage is it is highly operator dependent. Okay. And other disadvantage is if the vessel is very tortuous, you will not be able to do the entire course. You will not be able to study the entire course of the artery. So the other approach is to do an intrarenal Doppler where you analyze the intrarenal waveforms. And based on certain parameters of intrarenal waveforms, you predict the presence of stenosis in the graft renal artery. And studies have shown that always a combination approach is preferred in diagnosing renal artery stenosis with a Doppler. So this is an extrarenal Doppler where you are tracing the entire graft renal artery from the origin to the hilum. And you can see this is an end-to-side anastomosis because you can trace the iliac artery both proximal and distal to the site of anastomosis. An important parameter that are studied in extrarenal Doppler are, first is you study the peak systolic velocity. If peak systolic velocity is more than 200 cm per second at any point along the graft renal artery, it is suggestive of renal artery stenosis. Besides, if there is color aliasing. Color aliasing means you have multiple signals within a segment. There is, normally you have a red signal in the artery and a blue signal in the vein, but you have a mixture of signals here, you get all sort of color in one particular segment, it is called color aliasing. And if you have a velocity gradient between the proximal iliac segment and the renal segment of more than 2:1, and these three criteria are extrarenal criteria to diagnose transplant renal artery stenosis. In the intrarenal waveform, you have to angle the probe parallel to the interlobar artery. The angle of insonation should not be more than 60 degrees as described for AV fistula. Here you look at the peak systolic velocity and the end diastolic velocity, and you have to calculate the resistive index. The resistive index is calculated by the formula PSV minus ED, that is peak systolic minus end diastolic velocity divided by peak systolic velocity. If the resistive index is below 0.5, then it is suggestive of renal artery stenosis. And you also measure the acceleration time, which is the beginning of the systolic peak to the attainment of the systolic peak. This latency is called acceleration time, and if it is more than 80 milliseconds, it is called as the Parvacet-Tardus pattern. So presence of this Parvacet-Tardus or low resistive index in the intrarenal waveform is suggestive of transplant renal artery stenosis. So but remember, we should always use the combination of these extrarenal and the intrarenal criteria in order to diagnose TRAS. So there are a lot of disadvantages to the Doppler. One is that within the first 72 hours after transplant, you have falsely high peak systolic velocities. So you cannot diagnose TRAS within 72 hours after renal transplant. You can have spurious flow velocities if the vessels are tortuous or if you are holding the probe at a wrong angle of insonation. It has a very low predictive value, highly operator dependent. Accessory artery stenosis is not visualized by Doppler, and it is difficult in obese individuals. So it is in these situations you do CT or MR angiography. If your center have the facility of contrast enhanced Doppler, you can do without CT or MR angiography. This is an advancement in Doppler where you inject microbubbles into the circulation and then you can image all these vessels under Doppler guidance. The advantage of contrast enhanced Doppler is it is not operator dependent, you need not visualize the renal artery stenosis, and you get information on both total and regional blood flow by using contrast enhanced Doppler. Coming to angiography, we know that MR and CT are for screening, and this is done mainly when the Doppler does not give enough information. But both these investigations cannot be done when the patient has significant renal dysfunction. So most of the time, if there is high suspicion of renal artery stenosis and if the patient has significant renal dysfunction, we directly go ahead to digital subtraction angiography, or if the center has the facility, you do a CO2 angiography. So this is a CT 3D reconstruction that shows how the renal artery stenosis can be well visualized using CT angiography, but unfortunately in many of the patients we are not able to do this because of the volume of contrast that is required to perform the procedure. This is a case of thinking of the renal artery which presented immediately post transplant, and this is especially common when you harvest the right graft kidney and anastomose to the right layer fossa, because the right vein is very short and the artery is excessively long, and if you don't trim the artery to this length of the vein, you might get thinking of this artery. So the digital subtraction angiography is currently the gold standard. The advantage is that you have attenuation of bone and soft tissue opacities in DSA, and the contrast that is used in DSA is highly diluted. It is used in a 3:1 dilution. So even if you use 20 ml of contrast, you are just giving contrast equivalent to 3 ml of full strength contrast. And because it requires less contrast, you can take numerous projections in order to localize the stenosis. Compared to conventional angiography, the resolution is definitely less. So CO2 angiography is a recent advancement. It is a negative contrast agent, but you have to stack optimal carbon dioxide in order to produce a good image. And if the facility is available, this is the best investigation of choice in patient renal dysfunction. So, but after doing the imaging, then before revascularization, you have to ensure that the kidney is salvageable. You have to do a resistive index and ensure that it is not more than 0.8. And if necessary, you may have to perform a biopsy. And on biopsy, if you see only tubular atrophy and glomerular ischemia, then definitely this patient might benefit the revascularization. Whereas if the patient have advanced interstitial fibrosis, then he is unlikely to benefit from revascularization. So the management can be divided into conservative, PTA or surgery. The three modalities of management. Conservative, even though people argue that TRAS is a form of one kidney, one clip model, and you should always revascularize, but there is a role of conservative management. If the stenosis is less than 50%, or if it is clinically silent, and it is between 50 to 75%. So revascularization is to be done only if it is either more than 70%, or if the pressure gradient is more than 15 millimeters of mercury, or if the stenosis is more than 50% and patient have clinical manifestations. So this is one evidence that shows that conservative management is possible in TRAS, and this was a retrospective clinical study which compared the 3 years of follow-up of 34 patients who had TRAS of more than 50% but did not have any clinical manifestations. When they were compared with 34 renal transplant patients without TRAS, it was found that the stenotic group showed gradually decreasing peak systolic velocities on follow-up. So the transplant renal artery stenosis show some amount of resolution with time, and that's why all patients need not be revascularized. And coming to percutaneous transfemoral angioplasty, this is definitely the most preferred option because it has a high clinical success rate of 85 to 90% in terms of serum creatinine levels and 60 to 80% in terms of blood pressure control, but there is a chance of restenosis. So we have to do stenting in cases where it is recurrent, where the residual stenosis is more than 30%, or there is a flow limiting dissection. So I'm not going into detail of the procedure, but I'm just showing some clinical scenarios where this PTA have shown success. So first is a 12-year-old girl who has presented with refractory hypertension post-transplant at the 4th month. And on angiography, you can see that the entire iliac system is normal, whereas there is a stenosis at the anastomotic site, and this is an end-to-site anastomosis. It is always important to perform a complete iliac angiography before you selectively catheterize the graft renal artery, so that you don't miss any stenosis of the iliac arteries also. And in this case, you see that the stenosis is at the anastomotic site, which is the most common site of stenosis. After this, a balloon was passed over this guide wire, and the diameter of the balloon is determined by the diameter of the renal artery that was assessed by the pre-procedure angiography. And once the balloon is passed, you can see the waist determining the site of stenosis. Now, after determining the site of stenosis, the balloon is then inflated to the size of the renal artery by using 1 to 2 atmospheric pressure over the syringe, and then the stenosis is dilated. And after dilating the stenosis, you again perform an angiography in order to ensure that you have dilated it. And technical success is defined as one in which the residual stenosis is less than 30% from the baseline. But The clinical success is one in which the improvement in blood pressure and serum creatinine occurs within 3 to 5 days of the procedure. So if you have attained a technical success, but if you have not attained a clinical success, that means you have revascularized the wrong patient. This is another example of iliac stenosis. This is to emphasize the importance of doing a complete iliac angiography before doing intervention in case of renal artery stenosis. And this is a situation where you have recurrent RAS in a 51-year-old man, and after doing an angioplasty, you can see that there is a residual stenosis at the anastomotic site, and therefore this person definitely requires a stenting. And stenting is done at the same site, and this is stent is mounted on a same size balloon, and then it can be deployed at the site of dilatation so that the patient does not develop restenosis. He has to be on double antiplatelets for 3 months, after which he can be on single antiplatelet. So the role of surgery is very minimal in case of TRAS. It is reserved for failed PTRA or inaccessible lesions. And there are a lot of techniques available, and sometimes in order to minimize ischemia time, you might have to do auto transplantation. The success rate is good, but there is high morbidity and mortality, and that is why you generally avoid surgery unless it is complex lesion. So this is an article published in NDT that have retrospectively studied the outcome of patients who have underwent the 3 modalities of therapy, and that definitely showed that in patients who have hemodynamically significant stenosis, PTRA, the angioplasty, has the best outcome. The surgical and the conservative therapy obviously have a very poor outcome. And it has been shown that the technical success as well as the clinical success are much higher when you do PTA rather than surgery. And the complications are also less than 10%. And therefore, to conclude, TRAS is a potentially treatable cause of refractory hypertension and graft dysfunction. Unlike atherosclerotic renal artery stenosis, the TRAS shows good response to revascularization when detected appropriately, provided you have tested for salvageability of the kidney before doing the procedure. The knowledge of vascular anatomy is very important, and you have to do both anatomic as well as hemodynamic assessment prior to the procedure, and you have to predict the salvageability. The preferred modality of treatment is a percutaneous transluminal angioplasty, but we require randomized studies in order to compare whether conservative treatment in TRAS, selected cases of TRAS, is warranted.